I want to shift to Iran for a brief moment, because reports earlier this week said that President Trump decided against a strike on Iran. That was something that he decided against. We know that Israel took some actions against Iranian forces in Syria last night, but a lot of people are saying that a Biden administration could be a return back to the way that we treated Iran beforehand. Do you suspect that would be the case?
Well, you know, the only thing we have to show for a Biden policy vis-a-vis Iran is the Obama years when Biden was vice president, because we have not seen any sort of plan by Kamala Harris and Joe Biden regarding what they would do with Iran. Now, let's assume that they do go back to an Obama era foreign policy regarding Iran. Would it mean appeasement with the mullahs of Iran rather than engagement with the people of Iran, which is what President Trump has attempted to do? You know, the course that we're taking right now has proven to be the correct course in dealing with the Iranian regime, to apply pressure, to apply sanctions that are targeted, and to the best of their ability, avoid hurting the Iranian people and are targeted more towards sectors that affect the Iranian regime. The people of Iran are telling us this, that they prefer the pressure on their government rather than to have, you know, this appeasement or a very fake piece of paper and, you know, a nuclear deal that means nothing. It has meant nothing to the lives of the everyday Iranian people.
And I think it's worth pointing out, too, that the reason why President Trump was mulling a strike against Iran is because they were ramping up their nuclear program in violation of that 2015 accord, at least according to the United Nations, who did a report based off of that. And so we know that the president did not follow through on that strike, obviously, since, I mean, it never happened. But there are questions now, too. I mean, you bring up the people of Iran, and I think it's a very important point to bring up that there is an organic movement happening there absent any U.S. pressure. I mean, we see them going to the streets. We see them speaking out against their government more so than they have in the past. But if we were to take troops out of the Middle East, hypothetically, just all of them, would that change anything necessarily, or would we still have a presence in another way?
You know, it's so interesting that you bring that up, because it circles back to your initial point that the future of the Middle East is in the hands of the people of the Middle East. In each place, whether it's Iran or Afghanistan, Iraq, Syria, and all the places where we're seeing turmoil. And the best indicator of that is to look at the Abraham Accords, the peace deal, or I should say economic deal, that incentivized peace across the region between Israel and the and modern Arab nations. And why do I bring that up? Because that just shows us that the people of the Middle East, the Arabs of these countries, have decided that we want to take the future into our own hands. We want to create a better environment where we can have a trade partner in Israel, a tourism partner in Israel. We can exchange apps and maybe a COVID vaccine with Israel. That just shows where the region is headed. The young people of the region want a better future. They don't want to be stuck into the algorithms of the past that hasn't worked for them. And what President Trump is doing is removing us from that equation that just has not worked. The way that we will be involved is if a potential Biden administration or anyone else who comes in the next decade or so follows what President Trump has done, and that is to empower the people of the Middle East, to incentivize trade, peace deals, and everything else, and to put it into their own hands to create a future for themselves.
And Lisa, before I let you go too, you bring up a really interesting point. Is it better to deal with Iran, for example, by dealing with our allies around Iran, or perhaps people that were formerly adversaries and now are willing to come to the table? Is that how we should be handling foreign policy as compared to going directly to Iran and meeting their demands?
Look, with foreign policy, there is no one-size-fits-all solution, and I think that that has been the mistake of previous White House administrations. The key with Iran, specifically, because you asked, is to deal with the biggest Achilles heel facing Iran, and that is not its neighbors, and it's not the United States, but it's its own people, 80-plus million people who will come to the streets, who are willing to sacrifice their lives, their livelihood, and everything else to have a better future. They're asking for regime change. They're asking for the toppling of the supreme leader, Ali Khamenei, and they have spoken. What we need to do is, again, empower them, make their voices heard, and allow them to do what's best for their future.
I think that's very well said, because even over the past 10 years, we have seen those organic type of movements breaking out throughout the Middle East. I don't think it's too crazy to assume that the same thing could happen with the people of Iran. They're a hardworking, smart people who have been preparing for this moment for decades. And I think that we are reaching that point where we might see some action in the near future. But Lisa Daftari, it's a real pleasure having you on the program tonight, breaking down what's happening in the Middle East. Thank you.
My pleasure.